Let's talk about roots and radicals. So we know, for example, that 5 squared is equal to 25. We also know that negative 5 squared is equal to 25 as well. So for that reason, we say that both 5 and negative 5 are what we call square roots of 25. So 5 and negative 5 are, and here's our new phrase, square roots of the number 25. Okay? So, with that definition of what it means to be a square root, can you think of what the square roots of 36 would be? Well, you might guess 6 and negative 6. So 6 and negative 6 are square roots of 36. Okay, so we have a special symbol. So often when you're thinking about square roots of a number, often you want to focus on the positive one. So I can see that there are two. What happens if you just want to denote the positive square root? We have a special symbol in mathematics for that. So when you want to denote the positive square root, okay, when you want the positive one, here's the symbol you use for that. You write that. So this says, take the positive square root of, in this case, 36. Well, what is the positive square root of 36? That's equal to 6. Okay? So this doesn't say just take the square root of 36. It says take the positive one. I know that there are two, and the positive one is 36. And likewise, the positive square root of 49, that would be 7. And the positive square root of 25, well, that's equal to 5. So in all three cases, I chose the positive square root. So there's a little bit more terminology we want to be comfortable with. Now, generally speaking, what's going to happen is that this, so in this case, the 25 or the 49 or the 36, that is whatever you're taking, whatever's here, often is going to be more complicated. So later on, we're going to have expressions like this. The square root, or the positive square root, of 36 x squared y to the fourth. So all that's happened here is I've made what's in there a little more complicated. What's in there, that whole expression, has a special name. It's called the radicand. Radicand. So whatever's under this symbol, that's called the radicand. The symbol itself, the check mark, if you will, that has a special name too. That's called the radical symbol. So the check mark is called the radical symbol. So the radical symbol. So the radical symbol is just the check mark, if you will. The whole entire thing, that is the radical symbol plus the radicand, the whole thing, I'm going to try to circle that here now. So if you refer to the whole thing, that's called a radical expression. So a radical expression. Okay, so here the radical expression was the square root of 36, and here it's the square root of 49, and here it's the square root of 25. And here the entire radical expression is the square root of 36 x squared y to the fourth. And we'll be able to evaluate this radical, this complicated one a little bit later on, but right now we just want to make sure that we understand the terminology. Okay, so what if somebody asked you, just getting a little more complicated, What if somebody asked you to find the square root of 4/9? So notice how in this problem I just said the square root. I didn't say the positive square root, even though that's what the symbol means. And that's what we'll often do. From now on, it'll be understood that when I write this, I'm referring to the positive square root, even though I know that you know there are really two square roots. This denotes the positive one. So can you think of a number that you square, a positive number that you square to get 4 over 9? Wouldn't that be the fraction 2 over 3? And that's true, right? Because 2 over 3 times 2 over 3 is 4/9. Okay, how about this one? What if you're asked to find the square root of, how about, negative 16? Well, think about what this is asking you to do. It's saying, can you think of a number that you square to get negative 16? Well, the problem is that all the numbers we've met so far, which are called real numbers, anytime you multiply two real numbers together, what do you get? Well, you always get a positive, right? And the reason is because if the number is positive, well, positive times a positive is a positive. And if a number is a negative times a negative is a positive. So anytime you square a number, that is, you multiply it by itself, you're always going to get a positive. So you're never going to square a real number and get a negative. So this is not a real number. And notice how I've kind of left the door open in this case. I said, not a real number. I didn't say not a number. It turns out we're going to meet numbers later on that have this property, that when you square them, you get a negative. But right now, we're just talking about real numbers, and there's no real number with that property. Okay. Now, just like you know that, you know, it was 5 that, well, when you square 5 and you get 25, that was the reason why we said that 5 was a square root of 25. In this case, it was the positive square root. Okay? What if instead of squaring a number, what if you cube a number? So what if you take, let's say, 2 and you cube it? Well, what's 2 cubed? Isn't that 2 times 2 times 2? Well, that would be 8. So likewise, maybe there's a symbol to denote not the square root of a number, but in this case, the cube root of a number. And there is. And here's the symbol. So this is red, the cube root of 8. Now, do you see the way that I'm telling the reader that it's the cube root? It's that little symbol right there, the little 3 inside that little check mark, if you will. And that little symbol has a special name. It's called the index. Okay, so whatever little number is there, that's referring to the root you're talking about. So in this case, the cube root of 8, that's equal to positive 2. Now you might say, wait a minute, not so fast. Isn't this the positive cube root? And there's an interesting difference between this situation and that situation. Now why was I forced to think about the positive square root in this case? Well, that's because there were two numbers that squared that upon squaring give 25, right? 5 and negative 5, well, when you square both of those, you get 25. But now let me ask you, are there two numbers that you cube to get 8? Well, you might think that there's 2 and negative 2, but that's not true, right? Because what happens if you take negative 2 and you cube it? Well, when you cube a number, you're multiplying itself by, well, you're multiplying the number by itself 3 times, but 3 is an odd number. And so negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2, that brings you back to a negative. So negative 2 cubed is not positive 8, negative 2 cubed is negative 8. And what's the important distinction? Well, the important distinction is that when I write the cube root of 8, I didn't have to tell my reader, or I don't tell my reader, that this is the positive number that you cube to get 8. Why? Because there is no other number that you cube to get 8. 2 is the only one. So this symbol, the cube root of 8, does not always denote a positive like the square root does, right? The square root of a number is always positive, but the cube root of a number is not. In fact, I can see in this problem right here, right, that the cube root of negative 8, well, it's the number that I cube to get negative 8. And there is such a number, right? There is a real number. That number is negative 2. So we're seeing an important difference between square roots and cube roots. So with square roots, you cannot have a negative. With square roots, you cannot have a negative radicand. But with cube roots, you can have a negative radicand. Okay? Now, what would happen if instead of 3, let's say you change the index to 4. So what if you had something like this? Let's say you had the 4th root of 16. Well, what's this problem asking us? It's saying, can you think of a number that you raise to the 4th power to get 16? And can you? Well, yeah, right? 2. Because I noticed that 2 to the 4th is equal to 16. So this would be my answer, right? Is there another number that you raise to the 4th to get 16? And there is, right? It would be negative 2 to the 4th. And that's 16 as well. So you might ask yourself, why did I pick positive 2? And the answer is, just like with square roots, whenever you have to decide between two numbers where one is positive and one is negative, the radical, if it's an even index, that is, if you have an even index in your radical, that always denotes a positive. Let's write that down. That an even index means that you're always going to get a positive quantity. So that implies that you have a positive result. Okay, that's definitely not true for negatives, right? We saw a moment ago that you can have a, or that's not true for odds, I should say. We saw a moment ago that you can have an odd root or an odd index. And if you have an odd index, like the 3, you can have a negative result. But if it's an even index, like 2 or 4 or 6 or 8, you're always going to get a positive result. Now, one last point. Notice over here, with square roots, there's no number written there. That's because we always assume that it's a 2. So if you ever see a situation with a radical where the index is not written, you can assume that it's a 2. That is, you can assume that it's the square root. Okay, so in the next video, we'll talk more about radicals and roots and evaluate more complicated expressions.